Hi, I'm Dr. Sridhar Kalyanasundaram, consultant neonatologist and pediatrician. Welcome to my channel. In this video, we'll be discussing a very important topic which can cause irreversible brain injury in babies if you don't pick it up early. That is neonatal hypernatremia. So moving on to the presentation. So we have a case, a term baby born by normal vaginal delivery. Mother is a primie. Her blood group is O positive, baby is O positive as well. Baby was discharged on day 2 at 30 hours of age, which is the normal in most centers for a normal delivery. She had a lactation assessment on day 1, and the lactation support had mentioned that she needs additional support. And though the mother was confident, the latch was a bit difficult. So the education was done, she was shown how to express and so on. The birth weight of the baby is 2.9 kilos and at discharge the weight was 2.7 kilos at 30 hours of age, little over 5% weight loss. The TCB at discharge was 8 milligram percent, which was not high risk for the age of the baby. Mother was very keen to breastfeed exclusively and she lived with the husband with no other family support. The follow-up was arranged as is normal in the unit after 2 days from discharge. The husband had an emergency at work and they could not keep this appointment. So they came to the outpatient after 2 more days, which is by day 5 to 6. Mother mentioned that the baby was irritable and was not keen on feeding. There was reduced urine output and the baby felt warm, according to the mother. The weight had dropped 500 grams from the birth weight. Current weight was 2.4 kilograms. This was a 17% weight loss. The bilirubin had risen to 18 milligrams percent. The skin had a doughy feel. The anterior fontanelle was flat. The baby was irritable but consolable and still was keen to suck. The baby was admitted and the labs were sent urgently with cannulation. The serum sodium, as it was expected from the severe dehydration and the doughy feel of the skin and the irritability, came very high at 172 millimoles per liter. The renal function showed a raised urea and creatinine was slightly raised. Bilirubin was 18.8 milligrams percent, almost correlating with the transcutaneous bilirubin. The renal parameters, blood glucose, apart from the slightly raised urea which I mentioned above, were normal. The blood count and infection markers were normal, so the infection was not contributing to the poor feeding. The baby had a normal blood pressure, was perfusing well, and the urine output was maintained. So we can think about how to approach such patients, and that's what I will detail now. The baby was started on 100 ml per kilo per day of fluids, so we don't want to correct too rapidly. And the baby was still in a good condition, was not in shock, and it's safer to correct partly with IV fluids and partly with feed. So we went for 60% as oral feeds of express milk and formula. The baby was still able to suck neurologically normal, so we gave 2 hourly suck feeds. Baby was in an ICU on monitoring, obviously. And 40% was given as IV fluids, which was half normal saline with 5% dextrose. Serum sodium was checked after 4 hours and then 6 hourly. It reduced to 168, 161, 155 and 149, at which stage the baby was clinically well and we stopped monitoring because the trend was coming down. It wasn't too rapid a drop. The baby received phototherapy for 12 hours. Mainly it was dehydration related. So with the hydration itself, the bilirubin reduced well. No further treatment was needed. Baby was discharged after 2 days. There was no neurologic concerns. Cranial ultrasound was normal. The baby was seen at 2 years of age by myself all through with the follow-up, and all through the follow-up was normal. The development was normal. So this was a lucky baby where we had a normal good story. So the neonatal hypernatremia, unfortunately, is a potentially lethal condition, can be associated with cerebral edema, intracranial hemorrhage and seizures. So if you have excessive weight loss beyond 10% of the birth weight, it can be seen in approximately 15% of exclusively breastfeeding babies. 1/3 of these babies with excessive weight loss will be hypernatremic. So at the least, if it's more than 10% weight loss, you should ensure there is no further weight loss. And if the weight loss continues, you need to monitor the serum sodium. The usual clinical presentation includes jaundice, hyperthermia, poor oral intake, low urine output and lethargy. These are all non-specific signs. So your index of suspicion should be high, especially the accuracy of the birth weight is important because you base the follow-up weight on that, and all the weights should be naked weight in the first few weeks of life. So hyponatremia is sodium less than 135. The normal range is 135 to 145 millimoles per liter. If it is 146 to 149, it's a mild hypernatremia. Moderate hypernatremia from 150 to 169, and more than 170 is severe, obviously. In this baby, it was a severe hypernatremia. Luckily, the baby did not come to harm. So most cases are related to lactation failure, and high breast milk sodium could explain hypernatremia in some neonates. So this could be picked up during workup for jaundice, a non-specific clinical sign. So the baby may not have dehydration in these cases where it is due to the high breast milk sodium. Some cases are due to inappropriate preparation of the infant formula, or in older kids adding more salt to the diet. So this study by Macy et al. Showed the breast milk sodium levels varying quite a lot. The mean was shown to be 22 millimoles per liter in colostrum, which drops to 13 millimoles by day 5 to 10, and then after 15 days it drops to 7 millimoles per liter. So it can go as high as 88, and these are the babies where you may get hypernatremia without the weight loss. So if the baby is irritable, you still have to have a threshold to consider, because the sodium in the milk is quite variable. Lethargy, poor feeding are the main features. Obviously, irritability can be there in the early stages, but by the time they present, they go on to lethargy, and you can see the weight loss, 20%, 30% weight loss in most of them. And obviously, another risk factor is the primary gravida mother. So breastfeeding has to be supported very well by the mother. The adequate breast milk intake depends on several interrelated stages, such as normal mammary development, unimpeded initiation of lactation, which is lactogenesis, and sustained ongoing milk synthesis, which is galactopoiesis. Effective milk removal, this is the most important. The milk transfer should happen effectively. This depends on both effective maternal production and the infant's breastfeeding techniques combined with the intact milk ejection reflex. So it's a multiple factors that play a role. So the milk has to be produced, it has to be released appropriately, and the transfer has to happen to the baby. Total daily intake depends on the frequency and duration of the feed. So we should realize that the mother and the baby need support, especially since both are inexperienced in the case of a primary mother. So lactation support and education are essential, and careful follow-up and weight measurement are important. It will be helpful not only as preventive measures, but also in early identification of vulnerable infants. All teams should remember this when they decide on feeding support and follow-up. So the weight at discharge is very important. The amount of support they get is very important. So coming to the principles of correction, there are no guidelines as to which extent hypernatremic dehydration may be corrected exclusively by increasing oral feeds, when parental fluids are indicated, and which parental solution is appropriate to avoid excessive serum sodium correction. So we will discuss next as to why we shouldn't correct it too rapidly. Severely dehydrated infants must have their circulating blood volume recovered first. So if you need a bolus for compromised circulation, you can use normal saline in aliquots of 20 ml per kilo IV. But please include this volume in your calculations. Treatment is then with 5% dextrose and half normal saline in volumes equal to the calculated fluid deficit. It should be given over 2 to 3 days to avoid a rapid fall in serum osmolality, which would cause rapid movement of water into the cells and potentially cerebral edema. So this is the main concern. Hypernatremia itself can damage the brain, but correction of hypernatremia, if not done sensibly, can cause further brain damage. So please be careful. So this is to illustrate how in the acute phase, when the normal serum sodium is there, the osmolarity is maintained well. So this is the sodium and this is the water molecules. They are in balance. In the acute phase, we have the sodium and the water both. I mean, during the acute hypernatremia, the sodium and water both leave the cell. So if you correct rapidly, the water can get into the cell. In the chronic stage, especially when it's compensated, we get idiogenic osmoles, which get into the cell to get the water back into the cell. The sodium is still low. The idiogenic osmoles normally cannot leave the cell that fast. So when you're rehydrating, because the osmolarity in the vascular circulation will drop rapidly, the gradient changes and water may enter rapidly into the cell. So please remember that you may cause central pontine malnolysis or other problems if you rapidly correct hypernatremia, which has been persisting for a few days. So the maintenance fluid should be provided concurrently as well. The goal of treatment is to decrease the serum sodium by about 10 milliequivalent per liter per day, or 0.5 milliequivalent per liter per hour. So the drop should not exceed 1 millimole per hour at any phase of correction. So this is very important, and that's why we need 4 to 6 hourly sodium measurements with careful adjustment of the fluid rate. The body weight, serum electrolytes and urine volume and specific gravity must be monitored regularly. Once adequate urine output is seen, potassium is added to provide the maintenance requirements and replace urinary losses. So adequate lactation support is essential from the antenatal period, especially in the first 2 to 3 days post delivery. The weight review on day 2 and prior to discharge is very important to pick up the babies with excess weight loss. On average, we see 3% per day for the first 2 days. However, if the mother received IV fluid during labor, it's not uncommon to see close to 5% soon after the first 24 hours. In those cases as well, you just monitor the feeding and support it. It's 2% for each subsequent day. Greater than 10% weight loss is an alarm, and more than 12% is very significant. If it is more than 4 to 5% by 24 hours, we should encourage lactation consultant review, encourage the mother to express milk, hand express to start with, and then consider using a pump. If the mother is a working mom, she is likely to need the pump later, so buy a good electric pump at that stage. So it helps to establish lactation at this stage. After 5 to 7 days, she'll be fully breastfeeding. And when she starts working, or just before working, she starts expressing and storing the milk. The baby should be reviewed closely over the next 2 to 3 days to monitor the latch as well as the breast milk output. And as I said, consider the breast pump. Monitor the urine output and sleep pattern. And consider serum sodium in addition to bilirubin if the weight loss is exceeding 10 to 12%. It is essential to check the serum sodium if it's more than 12% weight loss. As I pointed out earlier, you might have a higher sodium in the blood even without weight loss in some cases. So if the baby is irritable, lethargic, or having any signs, you please check the sodium. Hypernatremia is a very important cause of preventable brain injury, and adequate feeding support and a clear plan to monitor and prevent excessive weight loss is important. Consider adding serum sodium as well as the blood glucose, bilirubin, etc. in the workup, especially if the baby is very irritable. So in terms of the correction, I mentioned that the fluid should be corrected slowly, and you don't want to bring it down to the normal level. So when you have the formula that is applied, you don't aim to look for the correction to normal of 140. So the expected serum sodium should be kept at 150 or 155. So it gradually comes down, especially if the level is very high, and then you can correct subsequently further. So when you calculate the fluid, you're safer doing it on lower level. And as I said, feeding is a more natural way, and if your baby is able to feed and is clinically well, you can do part of the fluids as feeds and part of it as IV fluid. If the baby is unwell, or if the sodium is really high with seizures and all, you can't feed the baby. So you have to be very conservative in your approach. I have not given the exact calculations here. They are available online as well. So these are the principles of correction. But the more important focus of my presentation is to make sure the mothers get breastfeeding support. Don't assume that lactation is natural. You have to support the mothers through the first 2 to 3 days. You have to make them aware of the risks, hypoglycemia, hypernatremia. And if there is a sign that the baby needs a top-up, don't hesitate to use formula, provided you educate the mother that it's a temporary measure and support her to produce her milk soon, so you don't need to continue the formula for longer than a day or so. I hope this is useful. So please subscribe and keep notifications on if not already done so. And please do share. Thank you.